For more on the presidential candidates and their environmental policies, CGTN's Rochelle Kufo spoke to Shweta Chakraborty, a risk and behavioral scientist. Rochelle began by asking her about the flaws in both plans.
I think both of them have made the effort to talk to the economic benefits that will come from both of their plans. And the problem with both of them in terms of how they try to reach their voting bases is that they are not speaking to the specific issues that hurt their voters. So for too long, Biden was talking about the science. As a scientist, I can appreciate the science. That's what I also would like to see communicated to the voting public. But when you are worried about getting food on your table, the last thing you need to hear is a bunch of data and evidence come your way. So what is it that really, really will motivate you to make better decisions for your individual livelihood, for your family's livelihood, for your community's livelihood? Biden has started to do that. So he is now speaking to the American public that might be teetering on which direction to vote, but speaking to them about economic opportunity is what they will need to be convinced to be able to vote for a cleaner future. The flaw with Trump is that he continues to make a massive disconnect between climate science, and he's gone in the extreme opposite direction of Biden, between climate science and the environment. He seems to think that there is some sort of disconnect there to say that I don't believe in climate change, but I'm against pollution. These things are inextricably connected. You cannot disconnect energy, environment, and climate change. So when he tries to say that it's fine, the planet, I care about air, I care about the environment, and I also want to plant a trillion trees, it sounds completely insincere and obviously at odds with the reality of the situation we're in. We need to plant trees because the planet is warming, because we as humans have not treated our environment with respect the way we needed to. So that is the two of them again are so night and day, but ultimately they are both speaking to the economic woes that America is facing now, and that could work out for both of them.
Now, obviously, world leaders and business leaders are watching all this unfold. How would you say their views about how America is handling the climate crisis and the environment has really changed over the past 4 years?
November 4th is such a critical date because that is the date that the U.S. will really be removing itself from the Paris Accords. It just goes to show how historic and how timely this election is to be on November 3rd, the day before that removal from the Paris Accords. The first thing future President Biden, that might have been a Freudian slip in there, has promised to do upon being elected is to again rejoin the Paris Accords. And that will send a signal to world leaders and communities around the world who need to see that America and China and India, the biggest polluters in the world, are willing to cooperate and are willing to lead together. Because the one criticism we get regularly from the Republican administration currently in power and generally conservatives in the U.S. is that why isn't the rest of the world doing anything? Why is it that America has to do it? And if America does it, we are going to be the ones who suffer while everybody else reaps the benefit. That narrative needs to change. That's not true. The reality is that we are all part of this environment and we are all really hurting ourselves by not really recognizing that the biggest polluters need to be the biggest leaders in this to actually see this transition come into reality. So America has to get back involved. This isn't a wait and see. This isn't a let's see what China and India and Brazil do. No, this is a collaboration that from November 4th onward, as we rejoin the Paris Accords, will allow for that signal to be sent to the world leaders and hopefully get us back on track.
And just lastly, it's almost hard to remember a time that climate change and the environment wasn't actually such a partisan issue. It was essentially just a science issue. How do you think that division along the lines has now shaped the way that we try and address some of this fallout?
It is really unfortunate. If you look back through decades of bipartisan efforts on environmental policy, there was not this much at all, this much partisanship and this much divide. It's become part of your identity in the United States as a conservative or as a liberal to either follow and to agree with the science versus not. And that's what's truly terrifying, because it should not be these issues should not be conflated. Whether you identify as a liberal should not also then be able to make clear where your stance is on climate. The fact that these have become so conflated just goes to show how much one's identity can really dictate their stance on a host of different science issues and risk issues, from climate change to views on police brutality to views on Black Lives Matter to COVID-19. We need to make a concerted effort to separate out our identities from our politics. And that's not just for individual mental health, but also just for evidence-based policymaking. If we don't look at the numbers, ultimately, what is guiding us? If we don't look at the statistics and the evidence, we are being guided by ideology. And nobody's going to win in that sense, because that's just, it's going to swing one way or the other. The most consistent governance forward is from science and evidence-based policy.